Once we've plotted up some data and found that we have a linear trend or a straight line relationship between one variable and another, we need to know how to interpret that. What does that actually mean? What is it telling us? And so we're going to start with an example. Again, an example of displacement versus time, and displacement in meters, time in seconds, and we're going to put in here a nice straight line. That is a straight line, ladies and gentlemen. A straight line which says that we have a linear relationship between displacement and time. Now, the whole point of graphing things like this is that the relationship tells us something about the physics of what's going on, and that slope usually represents some significant physical quantity. And so it's usually really important to know what that slope is, because it tells us something about the physics of what's going on. So it represents a physical quantity. The trick is figuring out what it represents. So what is our theoretical relationship, so our equation which describes the relationship between the displacement and the time? So I know that for the displacement at any time t, the displacement is the speed or the velocity times the time plus whatever the initial displacement was. So if we start off at d0 and then we travel at a constant speed for some period of time, then we'll end up at a displacement d at some later time. Now, isn't that interesting? That looks just like the equation for a straight line graph, and I'll show you what I mean. So if we write down y equals mx plus c here, and that will be familiar to you from maths, we can see that they have the same relationship or the same form. In our example here, displacement is on the vertical axis, and usually our y is the vertical axis. So let's show that those two are in the same place. So displacement is equivalent to the y-axis. The variable of time, so t, is equivalent to the x-axis. It's on the horizontal axis there. So we can actually measure things like the slope of a graph, and our slope in our normal xy graph is that value m there. So now we need to look at what that corresponds to in our distance or displacement time graph, and we find that it corresponds to the velocity. So if we measured the slope of that graph, that would give us the velocity of that motion. And also the y-intercept will give us that initial displacement. So the slope and the y-intercept represent physical quantities in this case. So our slope, the rise over run, is velocity. And you can see that that equals the change in distance over the change in time. And that can be used to show that actually we do get the right units out of that, because the units of the change in distance over the change in time is meters over seconds. And that is indeed the units of velocity. Let's have another look at another example which will be very familiar to you. We're going to plot the mass of a substance against the volume that it takes up. So imagine that we're taking different samples of something and measuring the mass and the volume, the mass in kilograms and the volume in cubic meters, and you plot that up and you get a straight line. But what does the slope of that line represent? Well, we'll have a look at the theoretical relationship between mass and volume, and we know that mass equals the density times volume, and that comes from the density being the mass divided by the volume. And again, we can compare that to y equals mx plus c and find that on our y-axis we have the mass, on our x-axis we have the volume, which leaves the slope being equal to the density. Now, what does our y-intercept correspond to? Well, it corresponds to nothing. So in this case, our theoretical relationship suggests that we'll have a zero intercept. And we can actually look at that in our data when we've plotted it up, see if we get a y-intercept that equals zero, and that will tell us something about any systematic uncertainty that we have in our data. And so again, slope is the rise over the run, it equals the density. Let's have a look at the units, kilograms over cubic meters, and that corresponds to the units of density. So that's just another confirmation that we're on the right track. A final example is something that you may not be familiar with. It's looking at the force as a function of the extension of a spring. So I'm going to plot up some axes here, force and extension of a spring. force in newtons, extension in meters, and I find that I get a straight line there if you did this experiment. The theoretical relationship says that we should get force equals negative kx, where k is something called the spring constant, and it's a characteristic of every different spring. If it is a stiffer spring, that spring constant will be different to something that has a very loose, easy to pull spring. It tells you something about what force is applied, what force needs to be applied to extend that spring. And so if we look at, again, y equals mx plus c, it's the form of a straight line. We see on the y-axis we can have the force there. On the x-axis we have the extension of the spring, and the gradient is equal to negative of the spring constant. And again, we're expecting an intercept of zero, and if we don't get one, then it means that there's something systematic going on in our readings. So again, slope, rise of a run equals the spring, negative of the spring constant, and the units of the spring constant are newtons per meter. And there we go, some examples of how we interpret linear graphs.